We're going to start with module 3, where we're going to discuss solving different kinds of equations and inequalities. So an equation is a statement that's asserting equality of two mathematical objects, and an inequality is a statement asserting the inequality of two mathematical objects. So note that we use the equal to sign to signify that two objects on the left and right are equal to each other. And we use the symbols of less than, greater than, less than or equal to, or greater than or equal to symbols to signify inequalities. Let's take some examples of equations. Let's try some. So we have polynomial on the left and a number on the right. So 2x plus 4 equals 3. You know, in the olden days, they did not use the equal to symbol. In fact, they wrote equations in words like twice a quantity, and 4 is 3. That's how they wrote equations. Isn't that interesting? So it's not that long ago that we started using the equal to symbol and this notation that we're used to right now. Here's another example of an equation. Here's another one. So here are a whole bunch of different examples of equations. So why don't you come up with an eighth one? Put any object that you've learned so far on one side, equaling any other object on the other side. Pause for a second and come up with any equation. These are all equations in one variables, one and two. This is an equation in two variables. The rest are all equations in one variable. So you can have as many variables as you want to make an equation. It doesn't always have to be just one variable equation. All right, to make inequalities, you just have to use the inequality symbol. So greater than or equal to, you're saying 2x plus 4 is greater than or equal to 3 minus x. So we can come up with a whole bunch of inequalities. So here are just some examples. There are many, many others, and you can come up with your own. The question is how to solve them. That's what we have to learn now. So the symbols used for equations and inequalities are as follows. We say A is equal to B. That means that this object is equaling this object. If we use the A and this symbol, that means A is smaller than B. Always remember that this open, you can think of it as a mouth. The mouth always opens to a bigger quantity. So A is smaller than B, or B is bigger than A. That's how you can read that. This would be A is bigger than B, or B is smaller than A. A is less than or equal to B. So we're saying A can be smaller than B, or it can be equal to B. That's what this little bar on the bottom means, less than or equal to. And this would be A is greater than or equal to B. So A can be bigger than B, or you're allowing for the possibility for A to be equaling B. So any number, when substituted for the variable in the original equation or inequality that gives us a true statement, is called a solution to that equation or inequality. The process in which we use mathematical properties of equality or inequality, respectively, to isolate the variable by itself is called solving the equation or inequality. So, for example, if x equals 3, if you take x equals 3, put it in this equation, look what we get. So we're substituting. 2 times 3 is minus 5. 2 times 3 is 6. 6 minus 5 is 1. And 1 is equaling 1. So x equals 3 makes this statement a true statement, which means that x equals 3 is a solution to this equation. Try x equals 5. 2 times 5. 10, 10 minus 5 is 5, 5 is not equal to 1. So 5 make this statement false. So 5 would not be a solution to this equation. Let's try x equals 2 in this inequality. 2 times 2, which is 4, 4 minus 5 is negative 1, and negative 1 is smaller than 3. So x equals 2 is a solution of this inequality. Let's try x equals 0. 2 times 0 is 0, 0 minus 5 is negative 5, negative 5 is smaller than 3, so 0 is another solution. So you can see there doesn't just have to be one solution. There can be lots, infinitely many solutions to an inequality. So what about x equals 6? 2 times 6 is 12. 12 minus 5 is 7. 7 is not less than 3. So that would not be a solution to this inequality. So 6, x equals 6 is not a solution to the inequality, but 2 was, 0 was, and there are many others. So solving an equation or inequality, you can think of it as untying a knot or undoing what was done to the variable to get into that location. And another way to think of it would be the reverse order of operations. You're trying to undoing algebraic operations means you are doing the opposite of order of operations to get to the variable. Let's do concrete examples then in a little bit. So first, there are different kinds of equations. An equation which is true for all values of the variable is called an identity. So for example, x times x equals x squared is an identity because no matter what number you put in here, like 2 times 2 is 2 squared because 4 equals 4. Any number you put in here, this is always going to be a true equation. So this is an identity. An equation in which you end up with a false statement no matter what value of the variable you put in is said to have no solution. So for example, let's try x plus 1 equals x. No matter what x value I pick and I add a 1 to it, I'm always going to get a number that's 1 bigger. I'm never going to get the original solution no matter what I do. So therefore, this equation is basically not going to have a solution. So I will have to say no solution. No real number satisfies this property. So certain tools that we'll be using for isolating the variables can sometimes lead to values of the variable that make the equation false. This mostly happens when you undo square roots or if you undo denominators. All right, so example, let's consider x equals 4 as my original equation. If by the process of multiplying both left and right-hand side, I create an equivalent equation, look what happens. X equals 4 is a solution to the original x equals 4 equation. However, in this equation, x equals 1 is also a solution because I'll get 0 equals 0. But 1 is not a solution to the original x equals 4 equation. So 1 would be an extraneous solution to x equals 4 equation. Sometimes you encounter equations in which, if you looked at the whole equation, you'll see automatically that certain x values have to be prevented in order for the equation to even make sense. So, for example, here we have 2 divided by x. We already know we cannot divide by zero denominators. So, in this case, the denominator x cannot equal 0. So, x equals 0 can never be a solution as it will make the denominator 0. What about here? Well, in order for square root 2 minus x to be a real number, which is what this 5 is, what do you have? You cannot have a negative number inside the square root. So that means that you cannot have x to be any number bigger than 2. For example, if you put 3 in for x, 2 minus 3 will give you a negative 1 inside the square root, which will be an imaginary number. So the largest x can be is 2. So for problems in the lectures that we're going to work with, the restrictions of no division by 0 and even roots of only non-negative numbers are some of the restrictions that you'll have to watch out for. So pay very careful attention because otherwise it will throw your solutions off. So once you find solutions to inequalities, you can represent the solutions to inequalities in the following forms. You can either do it algebraic inequality, so you will write that as a 2 smaller than x, so number on one side, variable on the other side. That's called algebraic inequality. Or you can represent your solution graphically using a number line. So you will draw a number line. And then 2 is smaller than x, so 2 is the number, so we plot 2. If it's less than, which means 2 is not included, then you put a hole at 2. If it's less than or equal to, you would shade it in to make it included. And then you have to shade a part of the number line. Are you going below 2 or are you going above 2? 2 is smaller than x. X is above 2. So you have to shade this region here. So above 2. If it was below 2, then you would have to go this direction. This is a graphical solution to the inequality 2 less than x. But you can also write the solution in something called the interval notation. So the interval notation we have to get used to because we're going to write all our solutions in either one of these three forms. So make sure you know how to do interval notation. We'll talk about that next.